done this many times in our museum.
Saloniki.
But really, since the most important part of the Kostakis collection has come here, and what I can see now here is something that is totally different to the better, I would say, because I see it from a new and fresh eye. I'm very happy to speak again about these works. Now, what we have done in this exhibition is that we tried to build something like an encyclopedia of Russian avant-garde, starting chronologically and moving through all the groups and movements and artists from the very beginning of the 20th century and up to the 30s. This is a very important period, not only in the art history, but also in the political history, in because there were so many political and social changes in Russia, as you know, in the beginning of 20th century. So this had a very strong impact to the artists as well. And we are speaking about the period that is right before and right after 1917, right before and right after the revolution, or the revolutions, if you want, because it was not one revolution, it was not only the October Revolution, 1917, but a series of revolts, revolutions, demonstrations, all kinds of such revolting activities, if I would say, that ended up to October 1917, when the Bolsheviks took the power and the whole state changed. So, of course, the artists did not start to do all these experimental works after 1917, because the revolutionary mentality existed long before. And I would say it existed even from the end of the 19th century, and even from the middle of the 19th century. There was this big political group or philosophical group of the nihilists in Russia. And after that, all these new theories of Leon Tolstoy and new philosophy, etc., etc. And from the very beginning of the 20th century, there was a big number of wars in which Russia was involved. And I'm starting from the Russian-Japanese War, that had a bad result for Russia. And this was the first time that the Tsars were criticized very strongly by the people. After that, as we know, from 1905 and after 1917, there were all these revolutions. Most of them were unsuccessful, and there was a big conflict between the people and the palace and the Tsars. And after 1917, we know that these conflicts continued, because there was a very harsh civil war in Russia from 1918 up to 1920, what is interesting is that at that time, although Russians were in a civil war, and the economical situation was very bad in the country, the artists continued to work, and some of the most important pieces of the avant-garde were made during the civil war. So this is what we're trying to show in this exhibition, how artists started all these experimentations from the very early 20th century and moved up to the 30s. So if you don't mind, we can go to the exhibition.
So, this section, which is the chronology for
chronology of the timeline of the Russian avant-garde. We start from the very early 20th century. Now, what happened then? We're speaking about the year 19,000, for example, this is the earliest work from 19,000. The very, very early works of the artists that later were named the artists of the Russian avant-garde, they were painting after what was happening in Europe at that time. They were following all the new trends in Europe. Symbolism, for example, was the most important, the strongest trend in Europe and in Russia, of course, and not only in the arts, not only in the visual arts, painting, but also in poetry, music, etc. And it was very strong. It was already 50 years the artists were working under this symbolist aesthetics, but not only that. In Central Europe, and especially in Paris, which was the center of the arts at that time, artists started experimenting with having in mind that there were new technologies like photography, for example, cinema, something that was totally new, and people could just see, there were all these new technologies that allowed the visitor or the people that would want to see what is depicted, that this can be happening in a very easy way. For example, photography is just a click on the machine, or this fantastic new art of that time of the cinema. So the artists felt that they had not that it was not necessary to paint in a very realistic manner, because this was something that could be done very easily through the new technology. So they started to cultivate the eye and try to do new things with the paintings. So the first modernist movements appeared, like Impressionism, for example, where the artists would draw in a more vague way. It is something that you get the impression of what is depicted, and not try to do it exactly as it is. So you can see here that all these early, very early works of the avant-garde, like this Kazimir Malevich, for example, this is a very small painting from the very early 20th century. It is after an impressionist style, but you can see here that some of his philosophical ideas are found here as well. For example, this is a house, and what is in the house gets out of the house. The interior of the house gets out, and it does all this frame that the interior of the house frames the outside of the house. This is something that we will see that Malevich after some years followed in his philosophical theories, when he did the Black Square and all these suprematist works. And also you can see how symbolism and the aesthetics of Art Deco in the very early 20th century appear here, for example, in these paintings by Ivan Pnyum, who is a very, very talented painter. You can see this female figure that has this inclination of her body. This is a portrait of his wife, and at that time his wife had tuberculosis. She was ill, and he did a series of paintings of her just because he felt that through a sort of a magic way, through painting, through art, he can make her feel better. So he did these paintings of his wife. You can see all these symbolist figures here, the shadows that have the form of horses, and this female figure that lies down, and the flowers that have the same inclination of the female body. And also the first painting over there, that is Ivan Klung himself. This is his self-portrait with his family, his wife that has again the same inclination of the body, and the three children. And of course, some drawings that are connected with the same theme. Now what I want to say here is connected up with the collector George Kostakis. In this exhibition, you will see paintings, big paintings that are completed. And also you will see many drawings and many sketches that are connected to the paintings. What George Kostakis did was he tried to establish the forgotten period of the Russian avant-garde from the beginning. He was looking everywhere to find everything that is connected with the Russian avant-garde, not only big and complete paintings, but also sketches, also archival material, everything in order to constitute this very important period and actually save this period of art from destruction and from oblivion. Because when he did that, when he started collecting in 1946, and through the 30 years of forming his collection, these works were not, how to say, legal. You would never see such works in the museums in Russia. So he really did a very hard research and digging, really, like an archaeologist, to find these works. Here we have two very early important paintings by Kazimir Malevich. This is also an example of how Central European trends in the painting influenced Russian art as well. This is very much influenced by Matisse, for example. This is a painting that is a dialogue with Fauvist movement. And Matisse at that time was living in Moscow for big periods of time, because there were two very important collectors in Russia, Shukin and Morozov. They were very rich people, and they were both collecting contemporary art from France, from Paris. Matisse was the favorite artist of Shukin. And he was inviting him to come to Moscow, and he was offering him studios. And both Morozov and Shukin had big villas where these collections were in. And they were opening these villas, these houses, to the public, like if they were museums. So the artists had the chance, and the avant-garde artists in their early, in their young age, had the chance to see what is happening in Europe, not only by traveling there, but it was more easy to see them in the collections of Shukin and Morozov. But this is something that has really an influence from what was happening in France. This is something totally different. This is a painting by Malevich from 1908. And here Malevich continues a bit further his own philosophical ideas. Malevich was very, very much concerned about what is hidden, what cannot be seen with the human eye. He realized from the beginning that what the painter does is to depict what is visible. And of course the photography does the same thing, and the cinema too. But he wanted to bring art a bit further and try to find, to recover what is not visible. Here there is a painting of a woman who is giving birth. They say that this is his wife bringing birth to their daughter. But this is not the important thing. The important thing that is, if you come closer and see this painting, you will see that there are many small embryons that are not really visible from far. You have to go very close to see them. Otherwise, you see this orange background as something that is a decoration and has the strong color that gives the tense of a woman giving birth to a child. But this is the starting point of his philosophy that later on continued to the creation of the movement of suprematism. So you can see that. Now, as I said earlier, there was a number of wars, and this feeling of a war being something totally destructive gave birth to a number of works of art. This theory of the destruction was something that the artist had in mind to put the beginning of a new art that would mean the total destruction of the past. What happened until then would have to stop, and we create a new world from the beginning. But before going to see that, I want to stop here, because you can see a number of posters here. These are prints, actually. They are prints that are made after a technique and aesthetics of the 17th and 18th century in Russia. These satirical works that reminds of comics also. They started in the 17th century, and they were showing. These were woodcuts, of course, at that time, with decorative subjects, with patriotic subjects like propaganda, the Russian, the Crimean War, etc., etc. Also religious themes. For example, if somebody didn't have the money to buy a religious icon in their house, they would buy one on paper, which was very cheap. And what the artists of the avant-garde did in 1914, when the First World War started, they were involved in this propaganda thing to make these caricatures, these comics, in order to show the role of Russia in the First World War. But what? Is most important that had to do with the war is that together with the development of the philosophical thinking of the artists, there was this thing, the reality of the war, which was something that was very strong, and the artists saw that in connection with the new aesthetics. That had to be with the total destruction of what happened in the past, and proposing a new start. So how to do that? This work, for example, this is a book, a handmade book, and this is a collage, which is also a relatively new technique. Of course, it was made in Paris at least one decade earlier, but this is from 1916. It's called Universal War. It is connected with the First World War. There is a number of poems, of very short poems, by a futurist poet named Alexei Kuchonin, and his partner, Olga Rozenova, made the collages. Each page is connected with a poem. The poems are written in what they call transrational language, a language that is not very easily understood. You can understand some words, some roots, but it is a futurist language. And the collages, the themes of the collages, they are also, as you see, non-objective. You cannot understand what is depicted here. Just forms, simple forms and colors.
So
this has to do with cultivating the eye in a totally different way. There is some help from the poet saying that this, for example, is called the war between the sky and Kronos. So one tries to find out where is sky and where is Kronos and what is happening. This is from 1916, but if you go to, you see this wall over there, which is a bit earlier, it's from 1912 to 1915. Here we understand that the artists continued to be in a dialogue with what was happening in Paris. In Paris at that time, there were two main avant-garde groups, movements, the Cubists and the Futurists. The Cubists from a bit earlier, from the very beginning of the 20th century, from 1906, 1907, the Futurists from 1909. There was a number of artists in Russia who were following what was happening in Europe, and they wanted to learn to be educated and go to Paris and study Cubism, because there were already academies in Paris from the second by the second generation of the Cubist artists that were teaching to the artists how to do Cubist works. For example, there was this academy, La Palette, where students of Picasso and Braque were teaching there. And a number of Russian artists, and mostly women, this is also very, very interesting. It's something that we have to keep in mind, that in the Russian avant-garde, there are many women, and the women are almost 50-50 to the men. And this is not happening in the other European avant-garde, the other historical avant-garde. Lyubov Popova, for example, and Vera Pesky, and Nadezhda Udaltsova, these two paintings. Together, the three of them, they were very close friends, and they went to Paris and both studied at the Academy La Palette, Cubism. They studied Cubism. But what was happening in Paris at that time? The Cubism was already established. The Futurists were in the streets, and they were much more bright, and they were much more fancy, and they were doing all these new experimentations. And what this artist did was to study Cubism, but also following what was happening with the Italian Futurists that were living mostly in Paris also at that time. And they went there in 1912, and they were still there in 1914 when the war started. And they had to take the train and sit in the train and go back to Russia in order to leave the war behind. So when they came back to Russia, they combined these two movements, Cubism and Futurism. So Cubism has this, as you know, the idea of breaking the image to pieces in a way that you have the feeling that you can see not from one perspective the image, but from many different perspectives. And at the same time, the Futurists try to do something different. They try to depict movement and time. And it was really something new, because there was the idea that movement cannot be depicted in the arts if you want to make someone to draw some person, for example, that is running, you will paint him in a very static manner like that. But what the Futurists did is that they have these motifs that are repeated, and they give the impression of a movement. So the artist that came from Paris to Moscow started combining the techniques of the Cubists and the Futurists, and did form the very first movement of the Russian avant-garde, very first big movement, because there are so many different movements that big movement in Russian avant-garde, which was Cuba Futurism. And they selected themes for their paintings that would show exactly this combination of breaking the image and depicting time. They try to do things that have to do with movement. You can see, for example, the Ozumerico here that has a movement. The running landscape that has a movement. The running landscape is something that is that we have felt sometimes, for example, when we are in a car, in a train, and we move in a car, and we see out of the window, and we are sort of absent-minded, and we have the feeling that it is not us who are running, but the landscape, and we are static. And also the ozonator that runs in the traveling woman. Now the traveling woman is a subject that in its theme, in its name, contains movement. The traveling woman is Popova herself. It's something like a self-portrait. Only you cannot see the woman here. Where is the woman? Where is the traveling woman? It's her memories or her expectations of the travel. And you can see all these different fragments of cubism and these motifs that are repeated, which is the technique that it is borrowed from futurism. And here there is a reproduction painting of Popova. This is done in 1915. And it says Cubo Futurismo. And from the other side, it is an earlier painting from 1914. You have to see it like that because it's from the other side. It says the canon, the canons. It has the flag of Italy. It has a fragment from a newspaper that speaks about the beginning of the war. And it shows very much what a strong impact had to the artist this beginning of the First World War. What was happening already from 1910 in Russia and during those years, 1912, 1914, 1916, and continues later, is that the artists collaborate with the poets. There is a very strong collaboration between the arts. There is a synthesis of the arts. And this is one of the characteristics of the Russian avant-garde, that arts collaborate, that it's not the musicians that are separate from the poets and the people of the theater that are separated from the painters, etc. All have a dialogue, and all these trends have their application to all the arts. But what is especially interesting at that time is the book seen as a separate object of art, as a limited artist. The very, very first books that were combinations and collaborations between artists and poets were made in 1910, and the very, very first one is this very small one, which is called A Trap for a Judges. It is written, there's futurist poetry in, and also woodcuts by artists. They didn't have the money to make a proper book, so they went to a fabric that made the wallpapers, and they took all the remains of the wallpapers that they didn't want to use, and they cut them in a very small format. You can see how small this book is. And each page is a different wallpaper. It's a different part of a wallpaper. And they made only 125 copies of this very small book, which is considered very rare now. But these are some of the examples of books that were made at that time, that were collaborations between artists and poets. And on the wall here, you can see also some lithographs, some prints that were parts of from books, pages from books. And this, for example, is an advertisement that Olga Rozenko, the artist that did the collages over there did in order to advertise the new books of her husband, her partner, Alexei John, who was a futurist poet. Now, going to this room, here we are in the suprematist room, and suprematism was the second big movement of the Russian avant-garde, which was totally Russian. And behind this movement was one very important artist, Kazimir Malevich. Kazimir Malevich started from also from Impressionism and Symbolism. He passed to Cube of Futurism. He did some primitive art, some trans-rational early surrealist, let's say, art. And in 1915, he participated in an exhibition called the 010 Last Futurist Exhibition in St. Petersburg, in Petrograd. The city was called Petrograd from 1914, when the First World War started, so that the name of the city is not German, because St. Petersburg is a German name, and Russians fought against the Germans, so they had to name the they had to find a Russian route for the city, and they called it Petrograd. And when Lenin died in 1924, the city started becoming Leningrad. Yes, and recently again St. Petersburg. So in Petrograd in 1915 there was this very important exhibition called the 010 Last Futurist Exhibition. Many artists participated in this exhibition. It was really a very, very experimental exhibition with lots of threads at that time. For example, some of those paintings that you just saw on that wall over there, they were presented in this exhibition. The Traveling Woman was there, and the two Daltsovas and the Vera Pestel were in this exhibition. Kazimir Malevich also participated in this exhibition, and he had two walls. On these walls, he presented for the first time a new movement in the art, which he called suprematism. Malevich was of Polish origin, and he spoke Polish too. And suprematy in Polish means domination. He wanted to speak about the domination of color and form above all other elements of painting. And what he did in these two walls was to show paintings that were in two dimensions without this element of perspective that the artists use. Two dimensions, only forms and color, all these four forms on off-white background like this, which was very important for him because it was not just a background, but he wanted to show that all these forms flow, let's say, suspended on a sort of a philosophical void. The most important work in this two-wall exhibition of Malevich, in this big exhibition, was the very well-known Black Square, which is the most seminal work of Russian avant-garde. And you can see behind you on the wall, there is a photograph of this 010 Last Futurist Exhibition. And you can see the two walls by Kazimir Malevich. He even had texts written on these walls with the principles of his new movement that he called the suprematism. And what is interesting is that he presented the Black Square, as you can see, on the corner of the two walls. Now, why he did that? He did that because he wanted to give religious characteristics to his Black Square. In the Orthodox, in the Christian Orthodox tradition, the icon is put on the corner between the two walls. And this has a symbolic character because it it shows that the icon protects the house in a better way, in a more stereo way, yes. So what he did the same thing with his black square, and of course he was very badly criticized for that. But he insisted that this new art is something more than an art. It's even something more than a philosophy. And he started writing big philosophical texts, because Kazimir Malevich is not only a painter, he's a philosopher as well, and he left really a big, big number of essays in which he speaks about his art. Now, he what he did in these suprematist paintings is that he took his earlier paintings and he covered them with this off-white color. And on top of that, he did these forms that you can see also in the photograph, which had different colors. They were not only black, of course, they had the intense colors like the red, the blue, yellow, etc. What he wanted to say is that people realize only a very small percentage of what exists in the world. We can see something, but this is not the world. This is only a very small part of it. And artists, through art, may have the ability to propose to us a big hidden world that is not visible, but exists. And he called this art also, apart from suprematism, he called it new realism. He said that what I'm doing is new realism. And he also said that what I'm doing is non-objective art, an art that has no object, no theme. He did these forms on paper, and without giving them a title, and after finishing them, he would see the painting and said, okay, now this is a man with a backpack, a boy with a backpack, or a footballer, for example. There is some material in the vitrine over there. Yes, there are two postal cards by Malevich, where he writes with his hand, he writes the title of his painting, but he finds the title after he did the painting, which is the different thing that was that happened in the arts a bit earlier. So a second very important thing for the Russian avant-garde, the first was the synthesis of the arts, yes? The second is the form, that form is more important than content. It is a form that can give, that can offer a new content, and not the opposite. Again, I will recall what Alexei Kuchonik, this futurist poet, said that has to do with this thought. He said that symbolism, for so many years, was so dominant to artists and poets that, for example, if I want to use the word lily, the flower, you know, everybody will think that I'm speaking about purity, because this is a symbol. But I just want to speak about flower, and not to give a second meaning that is so strongly put to the minds of the people that this is what is the second meaning of this word. I want to use just simply the word, but I cannot. So I will invent new words, and I will call the lily Eoi, which means nothing. But it is a futurist approach, very formalist, to the new poetry. The same happens with painting. So this is a non-objective art, and you could see that artists very quickly, and Popov, and Udaltsov, and Vera Pester, and Van Kloon, all the ones that we saw earlier, they started painting with forms and colors and lines, and also in two dimensions, because they thought that the third dimension, which is perspective, is not a real dimension. And Malevich was much interested in the fourth dimension, which was time, and then the third dimension. Of course, he was also a teacher, and he was teaching suprematism in a school of arts in a small city in Belarus now, which is called Vitebsk. His school was called UNOVIS, which is the initials for affirmation of the new art. Affirmation of the new art. This was the name of the school, UNOVIS. And on the vitrines, you will see some of the material that was printed in that school, the newspaper that they printed, and also a questionnaire that he was giving to the young students of the Brothers of Suprematism. His students continued his movement of suprematism, and they did some applications to production, to everyday life objects. And in this vitrine, you will see, okay, first of all, some Kandinskys, which was a very important figure in the avant-garde, which was a case by himself, a chapter by himself, Vasily Kandinsky. But also some pots and cups that were made by Malevich's students that decorate with suprematist paintings objects of everyday life, and they even create suprematist forms for this inkwell here. This is an inkwell, a suprematist inkwell. Yes, so you here we show these suprematist paintings. This is Ivan Klum, who was a friend of Malevich. He did these seven suprematist forms of color and texture. And this is interesting. If you come closer, you will see that he uses colors and techniques, painting techniques in different ways. So each small painting, of course, they have there's different form here, but in a different color. But you can see that there is a different texture also, because he uses different techniques and mixtures with the paints. And this is what Clement Redko also does here. Doing this black painting, which he calls suprematism, after, of course, the black square, yes? He uses four different kinds of black color, from gouache to, how is this called in English? They use it to make the streets. Asphalt, yes, asphalt. From gouache to asphalt, different kinds of blacks. And these different kinds of blacks do not give us only different feeling of the black color, different color, but also different texture. Texture was also very important. Now Malevich, when he was teaching, he proposed three different forms that he said that these are the basic forms of the suprematism and generally of the others. The one is the square. He did the black square. If he said that if we deconstruct the black square, we have a cross, which has four equal parts. This is not a religious symbol, this is just a form, a geometrical form for Malevich. And if one part of the cross starts moving, then we have a circle, because it goes round and we have a circle. And this was the black square on this white background, the black cross on the white background, and the black circle on the white background. These were the basic forms of by Malevich. Now his student, Ilya Chasny, did the opposite thing. He did the white cross on the black background, and of course, this can be written in many different ways, because just formalistic, I mean, not as a second meaning or a symbol. This art is against symbols anyway. But you can see that there are four black squares here. So you can see again that the white background and the four black squares. And I think that we can continue downstairs now. Here we come to a third section, which also is presented it for the third big movement of the Russian avant-garde, which is called constructivism. Constructivism was a movement, was also a very Russian movement, and the artists worked on this new movement in Moscow. Now in Leningrad they were doing different things. We will speak later about that. But what happened in Moscow in the 20s, because now we are after 1917, we're already during the Civil War, and right after the Civil War, when the new economical policy started in Russia and the people started feeling better, and there was some development, the new economy and freedom, there was a period that the Soviet Russia was a very, very free country, and the artists were collaborating with the politicians to create, to put the new ideas into life, etc. So the artists thought that they can offer new ideas to engineers, to designers, to architects, to create aesthetics of everyday life. And they used all the experience of their experimentations to put them into production, to put them into practice, to have the people feel that they are creating new aesthetics in a totally new country with a new ideology, a new way of living. And the artists started working in theater, they started working in the graphic design, they made covers for books, they made illustrations for books, they created new furniture, they created new textiles, and you can see this textile here, they just gave it to me. And these are all drawings for textiles, these are tobacco cases, tobacco boxes, glasses, and cups, and of course postal cards, and graphic design, and covers for new books, and clothes, and all these totally new aesthetics that would change what was the aesthetics before that, and do something really new that will be practical, that will be based on geometrical forms, that would have some balance, that would create a flexibility also. Also, this had its impact to work. What you see here is a plan that was drawn by one of the artists of constructivism called Gustav Klutzis. It is called the scientific organization of work. And what he writes here is how to have the best result out of work with the less effort. So these were new ideas, new theories about the work, about the people, about having free time also, which was something very important for them. And this was happening in Moscow. Constructivism, which later on, not very later, but this continued in the 30s when the avant-garde painting started to not be visible anymore. But what was visible and what would come from the avant-garde was architecture. And constructivism gave really new ideas to the architects. And until now, if you go to Moscow and to the ex-Soviet Union, we can still see some very important constructivist buildings from the 20s and the 30s. Now, in St. Petersburg, in Leningrad already, there is another way of painting. There is no constructivism there. There are no geometrical forms and simple colors like white, black, red, etc. But something that is more philosophical and sometimes even mystical, I would say. There were two important artists in the 20s in Leningrad. One was Pavel Filonov and the other was Mikhail Matyushin. Both had a group of students that were very devoted to their teaching. What the philologue was doing was, he called it analytical art, and he was drawing or painting, trying to fill all the gaps of the canvas or the paper, and to fill them in such a way that it is so tense that there is no place to draw or to paint something more. And you have the feeling that you get up to a certain point that the canvas, the painting, will explode. And this is his theory of how art can show to the people how the world started, how you can start from a big bang, from the creation, how the creation of something new can happen. His student, this is one of his students, Sulimir Samuilo, followed the same aesthetics with feeling with arts, etc. But this, you can see that this is something different than that. These three paintings are part of a big panel that Sulimir Samuilo did. He was part of a group of artists and poets that were very active in Leningrad in the end of the 20s, and they did performances, really very, very crazy and surreal performances, including also acrobats and etc. They would do these performances everywhere in the streets, not in theaters only. They had a publishing house where they worked together, and they did events in this publishing house. This was a group of very strong young artists that collaborated together with poets of that time, and they were called the Oberiu movement. Now, the second important figure in the avant-garde scene of Leningrad was Mikhail Matyushin. Mikhail Matyushin was a musician, and he was a teacher, of course, and an artist. He was a very good teacher. He had a group of students, and he taught at the State Institute of Artistic Culture. It was called Ginhuk in Leningrad. And his lesson was called Organic Culture, Organic Art. It was based on experimentations. All these experimentations had to do with nature. So you see, there is an opposite trend from what was happening in Moscow, in Leningrad. In Moscow, there was the technology, the graphic design, the balance, the geometry, three colors, etc., constructivism. Here we have an image that moves all the time. You have the feeling that it never ends. This is nature. This is the microcosmos and the macrocosmos. This is the sky, and this is what we see through the microscope. Okay. And this is what we see through the telescope also. So this is nature. And this is something that always moves. And the experimentations that the artist did and the students of Mikhail Matyushin had to do with this kind of depiction of the nature, but not realistic depiction of the nature. Again, the forms, the colors, the movement, the texture, the volume, also very important. The first row there, you can see five similar drawings that are the pictures of a lake. A lake that was added close to them. This was one of the lessons. He would go there with his students, and in different hours of the day, in the morning, in the evening, in the midnight, and from the same point of view, ask them to make a painting of the lake. Not a realistic painting of the lake, but again, the forms, the color, the light, etc. And also some other experimentations have to do with music. Skandinsky also did. Matyushin tried to paint music, tried to paint the sounds, to depict the sounds. And these two paintings are called painter in musical constructions. He was, as I told you, a musician as well. So this was a very big interest for him. And his student, Maria Ender, did also this, a number of works that she called sound transformation. And she was also very much interested in the experimentations of connection between sound and painting and image. Now, in this room, we have also a number of objects that come from the museum, from the Old Russian Museum of Decorative and Applied Arts in Moscow. And this shows how really what the artists wanted to do in order to create some new objects and how to show this new ideology that was formed at that time after the Bolsheviks in the 20s. You can see it on these objects, which are very ideological from one point of view, but from the other point of view, they use all the results of the experimentations of the artists that were made a decade earlier. So you can see some really very, very, very interesting objects here. And of course on the vitrine, like these chess figures, and these very interesting cups that are for milk. And they have the shape of a breast, yes? Female breast. And on the other wall, all these are drawing studies for textile, for fabric. And as I said, one of the again, having in mind that there was this synthesis of the arts, and theater was also very important, because theater connected all kinds of arts, and opera also, all kinds of arts. You could see in theater and in opera, you can have music, you can have literature, you can have visual arts, you can have movement, dancing. And it is the real form of the synthesis of the arts. And this was very important for the artists. So the constructivist aesthetics were applied in the theater. And not only in the setting, here you can see a reconstruction of a setting that was made by Lyubov Popova in 1923. For the Meyerhold Theater, which was a constructivist theater in Moscow, and for a performance, theater performance, it was after a play by Crommelin, the Belgian writer. It was called Magnificent Couple. You can see how this new setting is. You can imagine it, of course, bigger. There are some photographs there of the original setting. But you can see that this is a totally different setting, because it can change over time, and you don't have the usual objects and furniture that you put in theater in order to present a theatrical play. But on the wall here, there is a projection of a reconstruction again, this is new, of the first futurist opera from 1913. It was called Victory Over the Sun. And the Matyushin, which we saw in this room here, wrote the music, which was an atonic music, it was a cacophony. The Alexei Kuchonik, the futurist poet, wrote the libretto. It was written in a trans-rational language, not understandable language. And Kazimir Malevich did the settings. So the three of them did this futurist opera. And they presented it in 1913 in St. Petersburg, and of course there was lots of criticism, and people didn't like it, and the man that owned the theater told them that please stop, because I don't want to be here anymore. And this is a reconstruction of this first futurist opera that was called Victory Over the Sun. And here on these walls, created these new forms in a way that they would give ideas to architects and engineers. Popova did that, Lyubov Popova, Alexander Rodchenko, but mainly Gustav Klutzis, who was not an architect, he was a painter, he was a very communist in his ideological beliefs, but nevertheless he was executed in 1938 by the Stalin regime. And here Alexander Rodchenko, who was also very important artist of the avant-garde, he painted until 1921. And then he said, I will stop painting because I don't want to consider myself a painter, but a constructor. And what I want to do is be useful for the society and not doing something for decoration. These are some of his last paintings, which you will also see that over there. And you can see here how he mixes forms. He has this painting, which are different forms, like Malevich did with his own forms, and again this off-white surface. But now these forms can also take can be seen as something representational, as two human beings, for example. But originally, these are forms like as Malevich did his suprematist paintings. You can see the same on these Rodchenko's drawings here. And he was very much, he had this idea of the black circle, which you can see that it's here and it's here also in this painting. This also comes from Malevich and from his black circle, that was one of the basic forms of suprematism, that would mean the rotation, the movement for Malevich. We continue here. Okay, let's go first to this one. On this painting by Solomon Kniki, you can see exactly what we saw in Rodchenko's painting. Outside. It is called the synthesis of painting and architecture, and here again you see different forms from one part, but from the other part you can see something representational about the human figure. And you can also see a black square, not the whole black square, but half the black square. This is also a reference to suprematism, but this is not suprematism anymore. This has to do with something more practical, with giving, as I said, ideas to architecture, giving ideas to mechanics, speaking about that. In 1921, there were two important things that happened in Moscow again. One is the opening of an institute that was called Institute of Artistic Culture in Hook. And there were artists and architects working on this institute, working scientifically, I mean. And there was a dispute, there was a dialogue between them that lasted 4 months about what is construction and what is composition. And what is the relationship or the differences between the two, between construction and composition. On this wall here, you can see some of the results of this conversation. So here are architects, and these are for example, what Boris Karalev, an architect, said about this. For me, this is composition, and this is construction, it's the same thing. This is another architect, Konstantin Meduneski, said this is composition and this is construction. And Varvara Stepanova, who was not an architect, she was an artist, again, gave her own opinion about what is composition and what is construction. And you can see these pairs here that are connected with this teaching or dialogue that was in this institute. And another very important thing in 1921 is the Ogmoko exhibition. The exhibition of the union of young artists in Moscow. What they did, they gave them a space and they said, you do an exhibition. And these artists did just form, this is the construction of some of the exhibits of that important exhibition. You can see an original photograph over there of how they looked like. And this was something really, really new. We have descriptions of people that visited this exhibition, and they were in a very euphoric situation, feeling that this is something totally new. They would move across these new kinds of sculptures that had never seen such things before, flying sculptures or sculptures on bases, and made of wood or of metal. And they would feel that really this is something very inspirational, something that is about to create a new kind of aesthetics. And this was the first very important exhibition of constructivism from 1921. And of course, constructivism was the basic movement in Moscow through all the 20s. And it had this branch of art and production, which is also part of the constructivist movement. Now, in Russia, in the period of the avant-garde, there was also an avant-garde in sciences. Scientists tried to create, to open new theories about what is happening and in the world and where man could go up to. And there were many also philosophies after that. There was an important philosopher called Nikolai Fyodorov who had a theory that he named it the common task, the philosophy of the common task. What Nikolai Fyodorov said was that people are doing, they spend their time without doing important things. Okay, they do some important things, but most of the time is spent without meaning. So if all the people would concentrate on one common task, then very quickly, and not in 1,000 years, but maybe in 10 years, they would reach this target. And they asked him, okay, what is this common task that we could do? And he said, the resurrection of the dead. The resurrection of the dead is something that is conceived the human mind like something absolutely impossible. And he spoke about that not in a metaphysical way, but in a way of real, like through science, through technology, etc. And he said that we have to put a very difficult task, but we have to work on it. This had an effect, influenced a lot some artists. And what happened, what is very interesting, is that there is something that happened out of this philosophy of Nikolai Fyodorov, which seems utopic, maybe it is not, but it seems utopic. One of his students was called Konstantin Tsiolkovsky, and he was an engineer. He was a young engineer. And he thought, okay, I'm going to work for this common task. And what can I do as an engineer? When all the dead will be resurrected, there will be no space on the planet Earth to live. So we have to be able to live in other planets and fly to the space. So I will try to, as an engineer, to do these machines that would fly to the space. And Konstantin Tsiolkovsky is now the father of astrophysics, yes, astronautics. He is the engineer that designed the first rockets that could fly to space. Of course, he did not complete them. his students made what new ones based on his first or his own designs, but he worked so hard on that, so he put all his effort on that. And one reason why the Soviets were the first to fly in space was because there was this strong connection between art and philosophy and science in the beginning of the 20th century. It was connected with a movement in the arts. It was called cosmism. Cosmos in Russian means universe, space. And another artist, Ivan Kutyashov, he was the son of another engineer who was working with Konstantin Tsiolkovsky, and he was doing models of rockets. And his son Ivan Kudryashov, his father was Nikolai Kudryashov, who was working with Tsiolkovsky, and his son Ivan Kudryashov was going there with his father, and he was seeing all these fantastic new machines from the future that would fly to space. And when he became an artist, he invented a movement that was called cosmism. And these are some of the paintings that are connected with this movement, this luminescence and what remains of the launching of a rocket to the space. And over there you can see also some paintings that are connected with the flying to the space. And one of the paintings that are also to do with are between cosmism and suprematism and constructivism and have all these terms together is this painting by Gustav Klutsis, which is called Dynamic City. It has to do with suprematism because Gustav Klutsis was a student of Malevich, and what we see here as the basis of this painting is the black circle, the last of the three forms of the suprematism. But on the circle, he put these different layers that also have different, give a feeling of a different texture, that they make this painting look a little bit like three-dimensional. And what happens is that the circle becomes a sphere, and it becomes something like a planet, which floats again on this suprematist white, which is a sky, or according to Malevich, a philosophical void. And you can see this painting from all kinds of, from all parts. There's no perspective, there's no up, down, correct up, down, right, left. You can turn it from any part like a planet. It has the gravity from all kinds of parts if you turn it around. So it's also a planet, it's also suprematist work, but also a very strong constructivist work having to do with architecture. It continues here, and you can see afterwards how real applications on architecture can appear, and also how important color is, because one of the important lessons of the new schools of art of that time was the teaching of color. The teaching of color was really, really very important. We are already in the very end of the 20s, but also in the beginning of the 30s. And in 1932, it appeared for the first time the term socialist realism. And in 1934, this term was actually considered already as the only acceptable aesthetics for the arts. Not only for painting, but also for literature, or music, etc. So this meant that artists could not experimentate more. They had to turn back to a kind of realism that was the important way of painting of the 19th century. So forget all this period of avant-garde of experimentations and turn back to the 19th century to realistic painting, but also these realistic paintings had to glorify the new communist era. It was already a starting period, and very soon, being a formalist, working with forms, with considering form more important than the content as suprematist and even constructivist did, was no acceptable anymore. And being a formalist was something like being a national traitor. And many artists were arrested for being formalists, with this accusation of formalist. And some of them were even executed, like, for example, Gustav Klutzis and Alexander Drevin. You can see these paintings, these two paintings by Alexander Drevin here, which are really very impressive paintings. Now, what happens is that the artists turn back to representation, turn back to having a theme and a subject and an object for the art. But the artists of the avant-garde cannot make socialist realism. There's not one single artist of the avant-garde that did this, his turn to socialist realism. Most of them stopped painting, or painted only for themselves. Some did turn to going to illustrations of children's books, because this was something innocent. They could do some nice drawings for children, and they liked that, and this was a way of earning money. Some of the artists of the avant-garde continued teaching, but they would never show their works in exhibitions, etc. Malevich turned back to the presentation, and he did this. This is a small drawing, it's very characteristic from 1931. Two people that are carrying a black square, and this is Solomoni Kritin. These are paintings that have to do with funerals and death. You can see that there's a time when they make paintings turning back to a kind of realistic manner of painting, but these are quite depressive images of lonely figures on kind of dark background, like this screaming woman, or this man with a hat, or even if it's not dark but colorful, also sort of strange, because this, here you can see a lonely figure on an island on this gray background, and the only thing that saves this lonely figure is this colorful cloud that is on top of him, where some things are happening in this cloud. You can see the images in the cloud. And also surrealism, and also people that are artists that are trying to do works that glorify Lenin and the new era, etc., etc., but they are not socialist realism. For example, Solomon Kritin did this portrait of Lenin. This is Lenin, but this was not acceptable at that time. And this is also Lenin, and this is from 1930, and this is totally surrealism. This is Lenin with a female snow woman, yes, flying on a sky with two suns. But what is really interesting is that although such works of experimentations could not be seen anywhere in museums or in exhibitions in the 30s, and there was the feeling that all this was forgotten, and there was a big gap in the art history of Russia from the beginning of the 20th century until the 30s, so there was a gap of 30 years, and the artists could not show anywhere all these kinds of experimental works they did. We see that, for example, in 1943-44, during the Second World War, Alexander Rodchenko did paintings like that, or like that. And this is very, very interesting. Because, for example, this is a painting that reminds us very much of Jackson Pollock, of how Jackson Pollock does his drippings. Only that Jackson Pollock did that, his first dripping, 8 years after this painting. Now, why did Rodchenko did such a thing in 1943? He would never show this to anybody, and of course it was very dangerous to show that. His grandson told us that this certain painting was like a carpet on the wall on top of his daughter's bed. So it could be conceived again as an illustration for something that is connected with child with a child, and it is joyful what a small child would like to see, but at the same time it is really an experimental work of art, showing that the artists never stopped experimentating. They kept this through all the difficult years of the Stalin period, when they had officially to work on socialist realism, but the art was split between official and unofficial. And this term, official art and unofficial art, was very active in the Soviet Union until the perestroika times. And to finish with that, I will only say one last word about the collective Joseph Zagis, who did actually a very important mission, because he saved all these hidden world of the Russian avant-garde. He saved it from destruction and he saved it from oblivion. He was born in Moscow. His parents were Greek, born in Moscow in 1913, and he didn't have any special education. But when he started working as a driver at the Greek embassy, he realized that he likes to look for antique things and create small collections, and he had this eye to distinguish what is important in terms of historical, that had historical and aesthetic value. He didn't have lots of money, but he would buy and he would create some small collections, until he found accidentally a work of Russian avant-garde somewhere, and he asked what it is, and they told him that this is a work by Olga Rozenova. He took it to his house and he said, this is so important, it is like a window opened on the wall and bright light came out of this window, and he thought that he would need to find, to discover this work, this art, the avant-garde. And he did that. So he formed this very important collection of Russian avant-garde. And in the 60s, his apartment was already very, very well known. And he did the same thing that Shukin and Morozov did, as I told you, when we were downstairs, they had these big villas and these big collections, and they were extremely rich people, and they opened their villas to the public to go and see the French avant-garde of the beginning of the 20th century. Now, Kostakis did that in his very tiny three-room apartment in Moscow in the 60s and the 70s. He opened this house to everybody. Everybody could come and see, and the family lived there in the same apartment. But it was open, it was like an unofficial museum of modern art. And he was a foreigner in Moscow because he kept his Greek nationality and his Greek passport all the time. He managed to do that. After the war, he started working at the Canadian embassy, and he had this status of the foreigner, so it was easier for him. And really, if you see his guest books, his visitor books that are on digital form over there, you can see, for example, this is a page, this is something that
Chagall wrote his, on one of the visitors' books, you can see that the same day, in the morning, there's a number of students that came from a university, from a polytechnic school from Siberia in the morning, like 20 students, and in the evening, Edward Kennedy. And the next day, some people that come from a foreign embassy to see the works, or some art historians from abroad, and again some students and some local artists and David Rockefeller in the evening and all kinds of people that were visiting this apartment, which was full of art from the ceiling to the floor and minimal furniture, very few furniture. So this is the story of the collector George Kostakis, who left the Soviet Union in 1977, left a big number of works as a donation to the State Critical Gallery from his avant-garde collection, and he took the others out of the country, and these others now are at the State Museum of Contemporary Art in Thessaloniki in Greece, and most of them are here in this exhibition. Thank you.